Hello, one and all. This is Time Lord, and this is Cyber Ritz inside the Otaku basement. Unfortunately, we have a little bit of a problem with sound quality throughout the recording. Also, I do a bit of a rubbish intro, so I'm just going to put it out here. Our guest for this show is Carl Chegwin, aka TW Pikachu on YouTube. So, with that being said, this is Cyber Ritz, and we will catch you after the intro. One and all, and welcome to Cyber Ritz, your one-stop shop for all things anime. This is your electrical emporium. There is no cracker like a Cyber Ritz cracker, and I will be your cheese. This is an installment of Inside the Otaku Basement, and joining me for this one, this month, this time, this well-being, is a man. He is a man from up north. Reveal yourself!
I can't. Last time I did that, I did 18 months.
Yeah, we can't really do that. I mean, the whole of Doctor Who in the 80s was held back for less, you know.
True.
Yeah. So, hey, Carl.
Yes.
You're God Pikachu, aren't you?
Yeah, depends on who's asking, though.
I've got nothing. I've got absolutely nothing to that.
Nothing.
So, God Pikachus of the YouTubes.
Yes.
How did you get into anime?
It's a good question. I'm not entirely sure. It's probably the best one. The earliest I can ever recall coming into contact with anything kind of Japanese animation related was Inspector Gadget. Even though that's technically not an anime, it is because it was animated by a Japanese animation studio.
Mm-hmm.
And in Japan, it's called, Deku Gadget, or something like that. Traditional anime, as in stuff that was made in Japan for the Japanese market, I think the very first thing I saw was Laputa.
Castle in the Sky.
Yeah, Castle in the Sky.
Now, how did you watch that? Because I first came across Laputa on regional TV on a Sunday morning.
Yeah, I think it was something... No, it wasn't actually. It was on in the very, very early days of satellite TV.
Hmm.
We had a satellite dish, and when I say we had a satellite dish, it was like 8 feet across and bolted to the roof of the pub that we lived in at the time. And we got, you know, like the standard kind of what would now be called the Sky channels. But we could also get other stuff as well. And I remember it was on one of the, like, sort of film channels that was on there, because it basically... This dish, you could move it around, you know, you could press a button and it would change its position so you could pick up, you know, like American telly and stuff like that. And if I recall rightly, it was on one of the movie channels just one afternoon sometime during the school holidays. And I sat and watched it and I didn't actually know what it was at the time. But I just remember sitting watching it and just thinking, like, you know, unlike the normal cartoons that we get, you know, given where all the characters are all exaggerated and... you know, funny looking and do wacky things and stuff like that. You know, here we had a cartoon where the characters actually looked realistic and people actually died.
Oh, they did. You're talking about the latter half of that movie where you knew there was no coming back for a multitude of that army.
Yeah. People actually died, yeah. And it's like saying, it's. I mean, I wasn't actually aware of what it was at the time. It was only, you know, sort of years later when I, you know, kind of figured out what it was. But then it's like when I sort of made that discovery, I discovered that a lot of the stuff I used to watch when I was younger was actually anime. You know, things like Getarobo, Voltron, you know, all stuff like that. It was anime that had just been redubbed, you know, Battle of the Planets.
Yeah.
You know, all stuff like that. And it's like, you know, when you discover that, then you start delving into it a little bit more And then you find, you know, oh, this is the version that you were allowed to see, but, you know, the proper version is, you know, usually much better. And, you know, turns out it was right.
Absolutely. With Getter Robo, I know exactly which one you meant. Getter Robo G.
Getter Robo G, yeah.
And did you get that on VHS by chance?
I did, yeah.
Now, I'll say the descriptions of the episodes in my head and see if you agree. One of them involved a kid avenging the death of his father.
There was probably a couple like that.
It was that was pretty much the norm.
Yeah,
and then I think the other one involved a boat.
Probably, yes, it would have, because that would give an excuse to bring Poseidon out to play.
Yeah. I think you had the same video as me. Did it have a thing on the front cover that made it sound a bit Transformer-y?
Yes, it
is. Yeah!
It actually had a picture of the, what they call it, the Quintesson Judge. It had, like, Quintesson Judge in the middle, and then sort of smaller pictures of the characters, and then a picture of Dragon Formation.
Yeah, it was a bit like of fan art, wasn't it? Like some sort of drew it. Yeah, you had exactly the same video as me. That's why I wanted to pick your interest and pick your brains on that.
Yeah.
Because I think that was the only video of that came out.
Yeah, I think there was 2 or 3 episodes on it or something like that.
I think it was something like 2 episodes, and they just sort of squished it into one long story.
Yeah.
Even though it was blatantly 2 episodes.
Oh yeah. And that's what I say. Was it called Krypton Force or something?
That's it. Yeah.
And at least a lot of others as well. Just anime, because they did...
Mazinger.
Well, there was Mazinger. They did was it Starzinger, which was... Oh, I can't remember what it's called. It was basically the same storyline as Monkey.
Yeah.
It was basically three androids that had to escort a woman somewhere, except it was, instead of being like from, you know, India to Japan or whatever, it was, you know, from Earth to some other planet.
Hmm.
And the lead guy was basically Monkey.
Yeah. The back history of that... how that came to being was it was on public access TV, I believe, and it was a show called Force 5.
Yes, that's
it.
It
was marketed as like one long series, but none of these shows were actually connected.
No.
They all shared the Getter Robo theme. I remember that much because I did my homework when I started looking up stuff on YouTubes.
Yeah.
And that's when I found that, and I watched a few more episodes of the Star Avengers, or as they like to call them, the What was it called on the video? Because I know they said trans something. I think it was
Transbots or something like that.
Yeah, I can't remember. Transformators or something. You know, something that was like, we're not a Transformers knockoff at all,
yeah,
are we?
Transformators, that was it.
Yeah, Transformators.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. So, sort of a backpedal for you, really, on how you really first came to anime. Because a lot of us around the same age, about 30 to 40 years old, that's how we all first came to anime, is literally it was on the TV...
Like
reversioned into English, and we had no idea.
No.
I had one step forward in front of most of you guys, because when I was brought up in Wales, we had Voltron, but we had it in the Welsh language.
Yeah.
But I am buggered, because I can't find it anywhere. I know it exists. I used to watch it. They even did the Third Dimension one, where it was all in 3D?
I've got that, you know, on VCD somewhere, and you can change the language. You can have it in English or Welsh.
You've got it in Welsh?
Somewhere, yeah.
Oh, man, you've got to rip that.
Yeah. Big CD somewhere, yeah, Voltron the Third Dimension. And it's like I say, you can have it in English or Welsh.
Yeah. But they did the 70s show in Welsh as well. And that's how I first watched it. And I loved it when it was in Welsh. The actors were actually better in it.
Yeah.
So anyway, back to you.
Yeah. So yeah, I'm going to say, I mean, I watched all stuff like that. And, you know, it's like I say, you know, you had the stuff that sort of started me off, you know, like with, you know, the kind of sort of realistic animation style, you know, with like, you know, Inspector Gadget and Mysterious Cities of Gold and stuff like that.
Yeah.
That's anime. It was produced at the time when the French were really big into anime.
And still are.
They still are, yeah, to be fair. But that's what I say, a lot of their stuff doesn't get much mainstream. You know, it's like it was sort of a late 70s, early to mid 80s thing, and then it died off, and then it had a bit of a resurgence because we ended up with things like... Well, the Highlander, the animated series, was those sort of French realistic animation kind of things.
You know?
We've had the series 2 of Mysterious Cities of Gold, which was pretty good.
I've never seen an episode of it.
No,
I know Jai was freaking out about it when it first came out, naturally, because he's a big Mysterious Cities of Gold fan. But I've never actually managed to get a hold of an episode to watch properly in English.
The entire series was available to watch for free on the Kix website.
Yeah, it was, but I just never had the time to watch it.
I think it's gone now. I've got a box set of it. I went and bought it as soon as it came out.
Oh, man. I mean, I will watch it eventually. It's just one of those things. But the fact that Jai in particular went from really, really getting obsessed about it to not really saying much of a word about it kind of, you know, it kind of spells out to me that maybe it wasn't particularly good.
What happened with it was, is a lot of people were watching it on the Kix website because Kix, you can only get it on Freesat. So when it was like it was on the telly on a Saturday morning and then the following Saturday it would appear on the website. And after, I think it was after about 6 or 7 episodes, it just disappeared. Mm. I don't think it's been on anything else. You know, like usually about a year or so after, like Channel 5 or CITV or something like that will pick it up.
Yeah.
But it's not actually been on anything else as far as I'm aware. And it's like, say, I looked at thingy and saw it was coming out as a box set. And I just thought, well, I'll get it because, you know, I enjoyed the first episodes that I watched. And I watched a few of them that I, you know, got, you know, by other means in English.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, I've not seen the entire series, and I can't seem to get all of the entire series anywhere, so, you know, fuck it, I'll pay for a box set for it.
Hmm.
I wasn't disappointed at all. It's a really good series. Anyway, the anime. anime-related. After I'd gone through all that, you know, and found out about all the stuff that I watched when I was a kid, was actually anime, the first kind of proper, you know, like, ooh, I'm going to watch some Japanese cartoons because they're full of blood and swearing, sort of started... Everybody has a rite of passage of watching Akira at some point.
Yeah.
And it's a rite of passage, and my honest opinion of the Akira film is that it's an alright film, but it's overrated.
I agree with that.
Either it doesn't matter whether it's the original Japanese version or the English version, most of the time it's just exactly the same, barring the dubbing. They don't get much out of it for Western release. But it's very, very much overrated, and it's like I say, for a lot of people who are into anime or, you know, sort of got into anime around about the same time as we all did, you know, sort of early mid-90s, watching Akira was a rite of passage. And I watched Akira, and then I can remember Channel 4 one night had a, well, for about 2-3 months.
It was a while longer they did it in sort of like two blocks of seasons.
They got some sort of deal with Manga UK, and that's when I properly started. Cyber City Oedo 808.
Oh, yes. Big
fan. I can remember flicking on Channel 4 one Saturday night, just as that was coming on, and the very first time I heard Sengoku say, what was it? Now then, young man, isn't it late for a little lad like you to be out on his own? It's way past your bedtime, motherfucker. That was it. I was hooked. I had to watch the rest of... I watched the rest of the series when it was on over the course of 3 weeks. I went and bought it as soon as it came out on video, and I've still got my VHS or something. And then after that, they did the rest of the Cyberpunk collection. So they did Genocyber and was it AD Police?
I don't remember them doing Genocyber and AD Police for Channel 4.
Oh, they did. Yeah, they did. Basically, they did the entire Cyberpunk collection. And they had a little bit of
Hang on. I think... You sure you're not thinking of Bravo? Because I know Bravo did the whole of the Cyberpunk collection.
Yeah, they came along and did that.
Yeah.
Channel 4 did it first, and the thing is, they had it on. They showed the entire Cyberpunk collection once, as far as I remember, and then they had a rest for a while.
Yeah.
Of any kind of anime related stuff on at all. I think they filled the gap with Godzilla films. If I remember.
Oh, right. They did, but that was the Saturday and Friday nights, if I remember right.
Yeah.
I'll give you my vaguest memories of how that went down. They did the anime season as a part of the late night taboo thing, so it was in the midst of all this other stuff.
Yeah,
that they also put out, which were also intercontinental. But the ones I remember were Tokyo Babylon, Doomed Megalopolis, Devil Man.
Oh, God, yeah.
Then you had Cyber City Oedo, 808.
Yeah.
Shazanice. I think that was in the second block of anime they put out. The Legend of Prince Arislan.
Yes, they did. I think it was Dangayo as well.
Yeah, and then I think they wrapped it up with the entire run of Legend of the Four Kings.
Yes, they did, yeah.
Because I know that went on for so long that I actually moved countries midway through the run because I moved from Wales to England during that time.
They also had 3x3 Eyes on as well.
That's Shazan Eyes.
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
Yeah.
I've still got that. I remember taping it, and I've still got videos.
That's another thing you need to rip, and you need to send to Ross, so Ross can stop bitching.
I'm going to say I've got that. Mind you, how the hell do you rip off video? I don't even think I've got
it. It's easier than you think. Basically, if you get hold of one of those DVD recorders that's also a VHS recorder, which I found one in Curry's recently.
Of course, of course, this you know, this is in no way endorsing piracy.
It is a technical instruction from a man who knows nothing. Basically, you can transfer VHSs to hard drive, because a lot of those things are also hard drive recorders, DVD recorders, and the like. All you have to do is hook one up to the other or get one of those machines.
Yeah.
And that obviously turns the video into data. Then you can lift that data off that machine onto your computer and then obviously do the compression, condensing, encoding, rendering, all that other shenanigans you can do. And that's how you can do a VHS rip.
And then you, obviously, then you have a quote-unquote backup copy.
And you can also do what certain other people have done over the years, because it's on there on YouTube, Cyber City or Weedo. If you've got a certain soundtrack that's no longer used or licensed, you can transfer that audio onto a nice Blu-ray render of the same anime and then put it out on YouTube. That's how I reacquired Cyber City Oedo.
Yeah.
With the Rory McFarlane soundtrack.
Which is the best soundtrack.
Thank you. It is always the best soundtrack. The
rubbish US Manga Corp one, which was just fucking awful. In fact, I don't think they actually did that much to it, did they?
Well, what they did was they transferred the... I don't know how they did this, because it's different licenses, but they got hold of the audio track of the Manga UK dub.
Yeah.
But for some reason, they didn't have the license for the Roy McFarlane music.
They just used the original
music. They used the original Japanese soundtrack.
Yeah.
And it's one of the rarest instances I've ever seen that happen, because usually, when a different licensee gets hold of the rights of an anime, they just outright redubbed the thing.
Yeah.
But they didn't do this. What they did was they just used the same vocal track, but not the same soundtrack.
Yeah.
So
probably
weird.
Licensing issues or something like that.
It always is when it's something like that, especially when it's UK to US or US to UK. There's a lot of our dubs that just haven't been transferred over to the US.
There's a lot of brown envelopes that haven't been put into people's hands in order to make it happen either.
Well, I don't see the heel there, and I honestly couldn't comment.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's another one in the Cyber City camp. That's cool.
But that's it. The Legend of the Four Kings was just fucking awesome.
It was awesome to a point. That last episode, Carl, you cannot say that was good.
No, it lost a hell of a lot of stuff in translation. And they also lost a hell of a lot of stuff to the cutting room floor.
And I think a lot of us actually don't look to that anime with any kind of fondness because it led us to that certain point and then just stopped.
Yeah, I do. I still like it. I actually have a By Other Means copy of the entire series.
That is another one that also went to the US and got redubbed.
Yes, it did, yes.
Yeah, which is a shame. But, hey... C'est la vie! We dub stuff first.
And that's one of the things as well. Legend of the Four Kings, as far as I'm aware, has never been released on DVD by Manga UK because they lost the license for it.
Yeah, we literally lost it the minute we put all the shows out.
Yeah.
We did all that. It came out, had a limited shelf life, and then the rights just went up.
Yeah.
And someone else picked them up.
Yeah. Well, that's it. As far as I know, it's one of the few Manga UK titles that hasn't made it onto DVD. It's literally everything else, as I know Cyber City has. I know the what was the Cyberpunk collection has, and you know all the others, Aris Lan, what was the other one? Yeah, there's not many. I mean, I know all the Devilman stuff has. I've got Devilman somewhere around here. Because they did that magazine, didn't they?
Manga Force.
Yeah, because it was a weekly part work, weren't it, or Fortnite or something, and it was a very, well, what was laughingly called a magazine that was about 6 pages long.
It was one of Manga UK's last attempts to put certain animes out before they lost the licenses.
I mean, what is Manga UK still going?
It is sort of. They are a distributor at the moment. They're not actually a dubbing company.
Yeah, because they import a lot of. I think it was them that was behind the finally getting official releases of Dragon Ball Z in this country.
Yeah, and the only reason how they did that was they are an official European distributor for Funimation.
On a side related note, I can remember for a long, long time you could not get anything Dragon Ball Z related in this country because a French company owned the distribution rights to it and were literally holding on to them. And it was only after they had, I think it was on CNX, when CNX started showing Dragon Ball Z, and it finally started becoming popular enough that somebody actually stumped up the cash to basically tell those bloody Frenchies, you know, here's some money, now fuck off and let us make some money out of this, what people have been baying for years. Because that was it, the Dragon Ball Z card game, I was really into that, and I can remember any of the cards for it were like rocking or shit. It was literally, if you wanted a box, even though it was made in America, if you wanted a full booster box of whichever set had come out, you had to wait, usually about 3 months, and then end up paying about 80 quid for a full booster box, when at retail, which should only be about 40, 50.
Yeah.
You know?
That was during the huge sort of commercial boom of all things anime tied into kids' licenses late 90s.
Yeah, it was mid-late 90s, and it was, oh god, what was it? It was Pokemon that basically started it off.
Yep.
And then from Pokemon, so we ended up with Yu-Gi-Oh!
Yep.
Then we had all the Gundam stuff.
We had the deluxe toys.
Hmm?
Yeah, I remember going to Woolworths and seeing the Gundam wing.
Yep.
Like the big proper transforming one.
I have that.
Yeah.
What happened to it, but I had that. I'll go and say, and that's what I say. It was sort of mid-late 90s, we just suddenly got this massive flow of anime-related stuff, and, you know, it was cool to look, you know, cool to like anime. You could go to toy shops to buy anime stuff, and then it all of a sudden it just disappeared again.
So, it's because it, like everything else, it had a really limited shelf life. What happened was, somebody in America caught on to this big old thing called anime that was coming big, and they commercialized the crap out of it.
Oh,
so
yeah.
That's why we suddenly had things like Pokemon come out. We had Yu-Gi-Oh, Transformers, because this was early 2000s as well.
Yeah.
Like, it got to the point where if it wasn't Japanese made, the Western market were deliberately making their cartoons look like anime just to make it you know, fashionable.
Well, that's, they tried doing that in the, in the early 90s, because early 90s, you had, oh god, what do you have? Yeah, you had the anime thing, you know, that's when the sort of first anime boom happened. And you had the Exo Squad. Do you remember Exo Squad?
Yeah, well, I know Exo Squad very, very well. I actually got gruff into it, because for some weird reason, even though it was very quintessentially 90s, Gruffy never actually heard of it. And I introduced him to it, and he now has all the toys.
Yeah. I'm going to say Exo Squad was Sunday mornings on Channel 4.
Yeah, for me, it was Saturday afternoon on S4C, because we got it like a week after it aired in England.
Yeah. Yes, I can remember that, getting up on, basically, the only excuse I had for getting up on a Sunday morning before 10 o'clock was get up at 7 to sit and watch Exo Squad. Yeah, but that's what I say, we had all that. It's like Exo Squad was a Western anime, and it had been deliberately designed from the ground up to be a Western anime. You know, they wanted realistic-looking characters and, you know, more adult storylines and everything.
Yeah.
So they did it really well. The problem was with it was that because it was a cartoon, most TV channels just sort of like went, well, it's a cartoon, so we don't really have to pay any attention to running order, and we don't really have to, you know, schedule it where it can be watched regularly.
Mm.
You know, so by the time it got round to the second series of Exo Squad, people had stopped watching it because they either didn't know when it was on or they couldn't follow the storyline. So the third series, which would have been really good, never actually happened.
Yeah, and it is one of the biggest shames. I mean, I was very, very naughty. I didn't tell Gruffy how it ended. I said to him, you will absolutely love the ending of the show, knowing full well that there wasn't really an ending. Well, there was an ending to Exo Force. They did give it a smidgen of closure,
yeah,
but it still left you with an element of a cliffhanger to draw you into any further adventures.
Yeah, it's basically the main storyline of the war between humans and Neo-Sapiens was concluded by the final episode. And then the final sort of 10 minutes of the last episode built on something that happened about halfway through the second series, and, you know, would easily open a gateway for a third series about something else happening, which I'm not spoiling.
Nope.
That'd be a bastard, but I'm not a fucking bastard.
I think the closest comparison I can give the ending of Exo Squad is the Marvel US run of Transformers Generation 2.
Yes.
Where we actually had a story from beginning to end over 12 issues, but it still ended on a little wink, wink, nudge, nudge. There is more to come. You just have to look out for it.
Yeah.
You know, we're not trying to get more people to make it popular so we can continue the show, not at all.
Yeah.
You know, but that is the closest I can really give. To me, though, with Exo Squad, the only sort of comparison I can give to anime with that is not so much its visual style, because its visual style is very much of the same era as your Marvel and your Image sort of stuff.
Exo Squad is the imagery, even though the characters are all drawn as realistic and human-like as possible. A lot of the imagery used in it is very, very much sort of mid-late 80s.
Yeah.
In many ways, it's quite similar to BattleTech.
Yes.
Because they actually did a BattleTech cartoon as well, based on certain events that happened in the BattleTech universe. And that is, basically, BattleTech is a sort of what people in the 1980s thought the future would be like. And, you know, so it's like, say, when I remember, I recently sat and rewatched both Exo Squad and BattleTech, the animated series. And you can see that there are, even though the BattleTech series came after Exo Squad, there are a lot of similarities in Exo Squad. It's as though somebody who worked at was it Universal Animation, somebody who worked in the script writing department there, or the conceptual department, had obviously had some kind of experience, playing BattleTech or reading some of the BattleTech novels, when they were designing the theme for the universe kind of thing. But yeah, it's like I say, it's those sort of things, that era sort of. From about 1989 to about, probably say about 93, 94, there was a lot of Western attempts to produce an anime-esque cartoons. It didn't work as well as what they could. You know, you had your gems like, Exo Squad and BattleTech, and to a certain extent, Pirates of Dark Water.
Yes.
It didn't work very well because, it's like I say, the old, it's only cartoons, so TV stations would buy the series to show, and then they'd just show it completely out of order.
Yeah.
X made exactly the same mistake with Samurai Jack.
Yeah, that's another one. That's another one really, really steeped in Japanese lore. Just to rewind you back to just a moment ago, I mean, the point I was trying to make when it comes to Exo Squad is, even though visually you can't really tie it into anime, you can certainly tie in its writing style to anime, where it's an ongoing storyline that builds over time. Especially in today's market, where you've got like a show that runs all year long, and it's just one season, but it tells you a complete story from beginning to end.
Yeah. So I'd say it's Exo Squad was basically a space opera.
Yeah.
It dealt with a core characters and an ongoing theme, ongoing setting, struggle against adversity, and stuff happens, and things happen, people die, people don't die, but it was thematically, it was very, very Japanese, but image-wise, it was most certainly Western. But that's what I say, we had that kind of glut, of Western animation trying to compete against Japanese anime and failing miserably. And then it popped up again, sort of like, say, turn of the millennium time. And by that point, a lot of Japanese animation started to become a bit indistinguishable from Western.
Yeah.
Certain things, anyway, and especially, and it started getting a bit daft when, and you probably won't like me for saying this, when they did Sailor Moon.
Doesn't matter. I can take the criticism. So go on.
Sailor Moon, which is basically, it's in both an anime and a manga, which is basically designed to have lots of nude or semi-nude Japanese schoolgirls in, and they redubbed the cartoon version of it, or the anime version of it, into basically a Western cartoon, which kind of dispenses with the whole point of the series, which is naked ladies.
Yeah.
Yeah. They did the same thing with, let's do this one now, One Piece.
Oh, Christ, yes.
Four kids, yeah, nice one. One Piece. One Piece. Let's face it, the original One Piece, four kids fucked up their thingy to do One Piece, and Funimation basically took it off them and did it properly.
Yeah. One Piece
isn't... It's not terribly violent or offensive as a series. It certainly, could get away with being marketed in its original form as kind of a teen, young adult show.
Yeah.
But four kids decided that, they were just going to edit the shit out of it, to the point at which even the guy who created One Piece was disgusted with it.
Yeah.
And disowned it, basically. That's why 4Kids stopped making it.
4Kids willingly did that in the end, because it was a case of 4Kids were trying to get their hands on anything they could to basically keep that big old steamroller going that they had going with first Pokemon, and then, I think, did they do Digimon, or did Saban do Digimon?
I don't know who did Digimon.
I think Saban did Digimon, because Haim Saban did the theme tune and all of that.
didn't he?
Shuki Levy did. So, yeah, I think that was the band.
The band did Eagle Riders, which was a combination of Gatchaman 2 and Gatchaman Fighter.
Yes.
I really like that. And let's do this one as well, Samurai Pizza Cat.
It's a good example of when a dub is done so badly, but yet so deliberately, that it is so entertaining.
Basically, when you look at Samurai Pizza Cat and you look at the original material it's based on, they are completely different. And it's akin to, you know, things like Yu-Gi-Oh! Abridged.
Yeah.
It's basically what they did was they took the series and then went, there's not really that much we can do with this, so let's see what we can do by just doing it for laughs.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's what they did with Samurai Pizza Cat. And what they did with it was so amazing, it actually makes it better than the source material.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, apparently, according to Paul Roberts, Cyberit's podcaster extraordinaire, the original creators of that anime liked it so much, they literally said, well done, you made it better than we ever could. they loved it.
It is legendary. I remember watching that religiously every week when it was on, was it Motormouth?
Yeah, I think it was Motormouth. I know it was on the ITV Kids magazine show. I remember that much.
Because I can remember, it's one of the things I used to really hate about, you know, your Saturday morning cartoons in this country, when you used to have it on as part of, you know, Motormouth or Going Live or whatever. Mm. And they'd take a 30-minute episode, they'd play 15 minutes of it, then they'd cut it off and they'd have some stupid shit pop band on or something, and then they'd go back to the set part. It's like, no, we want the fucking cartoons.
Hey.
They got the idea right when they did, was it What's Up, Doc?
Yep.
And they just went, let them watch the cartoons, then we'll do our shit, you know, when the cartoons aren't on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm. I was going to say, the Samurai Pizza Cats, I mean, at least you had it cut into two, but you didn't have it cut into, like, less than 5-minute segments over the course of 5 days.
No.
Like you originally had with GoBots and Transformers.
Yes, I can remember, they did that on Whack-A-Day, didn't they?
Yes, they did.
They took to doing that with Power Rangers. You remember
They had Simon Parkin. He first introduced us to Mighty Morphin, and then he left.
Yeah.
And GMTV, because I think the Simon Parkin segments were done by Disney, they had an agreement with Disney, so all their children...
He actually owned, I think it was 1/3 of the GMTV company.
I think they might have done. They did the Disney Club after TVAM folded. I remember that much. But GMTV took the Mighty Morphin TV series for themselves because it was such a big money earner. And that's when they started putting it out in like little 5-minute segments. And that put me right off.
Yeah, because I remember I used to get up in the morning, you know, when I was going to school. And they'd come on and it was like during, you know, usually it was like you have to wait for school holidays for Power Rangers.
Mm.
It's like, now you can watch Power Rangers before you go to school. It's like, awesome. It's like a 5-minute blast of Power Rangers. Like, what?
Yeah, it doesn't work.
And then they'd like put it on and it'd be like, you know, Power Rangers theme tune, followed by, oh, and let's go to Ernie's and do something. Bulk and Skull turned up. And then all of a sudden it got to be continued. You're like, where's the
past? It also came at a time that I think they were showing the latter half of season one or the beginnings of season two. No, because the season two started with a 5-parter, so that wouldn't be right. Because season two of Mighty Morphin was actually more of a series of serialized stories that were like 5-part maximums or 2-parters. Oh. Mostly because of budget. Because they really didn't have that much footage left to show. So they used to space it out over 2 episodes.
Yeah, that's because that's what I say. By then, I would say when they got around to Series 2, they were still using Z-Ranger costumes.
Mm-hmm.
Not Kakuranger, Die-Ranger.
That's the one. Die-Ranger for the White Ranger and the Jew-Ranger ones.
Yeah.
They did that because the band was shit scared of changing it all up because they had a winning formula.
Yeah. Because it always used to make me laugh when you'd be watching the fighting scenes, and it's like it'd show you Thunder Megazord swinging its sword, and then when it cut to the sword hitting the creature, which they'd already killed off once in Series 1, it'd actually be the original Megazord's sword hit it. Or like, it'd kick, you know, Thunder Megazord would kick the creature, and it'd be the, you know, Triceratops' foot or something that actually connected with it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was stuff like that, and it's like, you see what's that, and it's like, huh? And that's one thing that got me into watching the... you know, like watching the sort of Mighty Morphin Power Rangers bits and videoing them and then, you know, freeze framing it at certain points.
Mm.
Because I remember watching the very first, I can't remember, it was one of the early episodes of Masked Rider.
Mm.
And I remember pausing it at just one point because I noticed when he did like a jump on his motorbike, And I just spotted, like, just maybe one or two frames where the motorbike was different. And I was like, and I just sort of, and I wound it back, and then, you know, sort of frame advanced it. And it changed from Black RX's bike to Black's bike.
Yeah.
Which was green and black. You know, and RX's bike was sort of red, blue, and yellow.
Yeah.
And I remember then, I'm like, what the hell's that? You know, and it's like saying it was a question that went unanswered until the advent of the internet.
And then we discovered it was because they basically ripped the footage when they could from other episodes from other Tokusatsu shows.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, at least we knew what we were getting into with VR Troopers.
Oh.
Here's a question whilst we're still talking about Tokusatsu.
Yeah.
When did you twig that you were watching Japanese footage in Power Rangers?
That one was one that Sky Magazine actually spoiled for me.
Hmm.
Because they had, I mean, I didn't have Sky at the time. A friend of mine had Sky.
Yeah.
They had a section in it about Power Rangers, because Power Rangers was on Sky first before it came onto GMTV. And they had, like, a section, and he brought it to school once, and I was sat reading it. And there was a big thing at the back of this, like, pull-out section about Power Rangers that explained what Power Rangers was. And because one of the things that GMTV and that used to do when they showed the episodes was they'd cut the end credits off, so you couldn't see where it said based on, you know, whatever, you know, like...
Yeah.
Power Rangers Series 1 was Zoo Ranger, and then Series 2 was Zoo Ranger and Die Ranger. And it told you in there, because it was a pull-out section about Series 2, and it said there, it said most of the footage that's used is from the Japanese TV series Zoo Ranger.
Yeah.
And it says Series 2 incorporates footage from another program called Die Ranger. And it says these programs are part of what is known as the Super Sentai series, since the 70s. And I was like, what?
I think I know which one you were saying. I don't think it was Sky. With us, it was an issue of... I can't remember. My memory's shoddy, but...
Yeah.
I think it was Gamesmaster or something. And it was at the point where Jason, Trini, and Zach left.
Yeah.
And they replaced them with Rocky, Adam, and Aisha. Yeah. And I remember people... There was a bit of an uproar. They said, oh, they've changed it all. Ah. And they said, if you think you're having problems with these three, feel sorry for Japan, because they fire the cast every year. That's the words they use. They fire the cast every year and start anew. I was like, do they? Because I always knew there was something a bit weird about the footage. Whenever they went from being civilians to Power Rangers, it was really, really bloody grainy. And then it twigged. Hang on. Rita looks Chinese. I didn't even know it was from Japan. Rita looks Chinese. Scorpina looks Chinese. Squat looks Chinese.
Yeah.
This footage is from someplace else.
And then I noticed in I can't remember which one of the episodes it was, but there was like an image on screen, and it was showing basically Tokyo Bay.
Mm.
You could see they've got like there's a bridge, and you could see Tokyo Tower in the background.
Yeah.
I knew that was something to do with Japan, you know, because both Godzilla and Gamera have destroyed Tokyo Tower several times. So, you know, it's like, and that's what I say, I sort of twigged down, and then when I read that thing in that, you know, that pull-out section from where Sky Magazine or whatever it was. And I was like, And then again, you know, it asked a lot of questions that didn't get answered until the advent of the internet.
Yeah.
That's what I say. It's all stuff like that. It's like I say, it's weird how for years people have been watching, you know, sort of Japanese stuff and not realised it.
Mm.
You know, especially like people our age that, you know, basically grew up with it. You know, you had your Voltrons and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Danger Mouse and, you know, Count Duckula and all that.
Yeah. With me, I always saw the distinction between such shows as Ulysses 31 and The Mysterious Cities of Gold compared to other things like The Raccoons and Danger Mouse and all of that. And I saw a distinctive style. Like, there was something like how they designed the eyes, the hair and all that, because I basically managed to get into the art parts of school at a very early age, and that's because I could see details.
Mm.
So in my mind, I already figured there was something a little different between those shows and the other shows. I mean, even stuff like Willy Fogg and Doc Tanyan, I knew there was a distinct difference.
They were Spanish, weren't they?
Well,
Willy Fogg and Doc Tanyan were Spanish produced, but the animation was done in Japan.
Yeah, and for the longest time, because a lot of this stuff that they had in the credits, like The Mysterious Cities of Gold, they would say Canal France or something. I thought that these were from France or Spain. I didn't know they were Japanese until I was like 9 or 10 years old. You know, even the aforementioned Go Get a Robo, it was done in such a way, and I think my dad even said bloody Mexicans or something. You know, so I just thought, well, obviously it's Mexican or something. You know, I didn't actually know they were outright Japanese until sort of later when I was about 10 or 9. And all this other stuff started coming about.
Yeah.
You know, Akira was big by 1990, 1991 in the UK. And by then I already figured out, okay, all this is Japanese.
Yeah.
So well, it's pretty interesting.
A lot of it as well. I mean, there's some stuff that was around sort of like mid-late 80s that was anime style, but it was actually Korean.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff. I mean, there's the sat and watched and did a review on.
Are you talking about that one where the robot was actually Inferno from the Transformers?
There's that, yeah, that's terrible. But there's also another one. It was called either Space Transformers or Micro Commando Diatron 5.
That sounds more likely Diatron 5.
Yeah, Diatron 5 is just off. If you want to torture yourself, look it up. It's on YouTube. It's down because there was two versions of it released in the West. There was Space Transformers, which was an extremely badly done Hong Kong dub.
Yeah.
And then there is Micro Commando Diatron 5, which was a little bit more professionally done. I think that was done in the Philippines or something like that. Basically, the star dubs of their time. The story itself makes absolutely no fucking sense whatsoever. It's just one of those things. You sit and watch it, and you'll be like, "Did somebody just drop some acid into my tea or something?" You know, it's literally, it's like that. It's like, I'm watching anime, because it is anime. There's no doubt about it, it is anime.
Yeah.
You know, it's done in the anime style. But it's like it's an unholy fusion of Japanese storytelling and artwork married up with Western cartoonisms.
Yeah.
And it's just awful, awful, awful. Especially the one where they use the character, I can't remember what that one's called. I think it's Space Kids, that's what that one's called, with the... where they use Inferno from Transformers as a character model. That one as well is absolutely terrible. But it's like, say, it's one of those ones that kind of showed up in the video shop.
Yeah.
You know, does anybody remember them going and getting a video out on a Friday night?
Well, funny enough, that's the theme of this very podcast, is because you're currently dwelling in the basement below my rental shop, and I'm actually hosting the show via this imaginary rental shop that exists in 1996 in October. According to Adam, so funny enough, this is where we're dwelling from.
Oh my god, it's a podcast with fluff. Ugh.
Indeed.
Yeah, right. Yeah, so we have those Korean efforts. There are a couple more, but their names escape me. I can see fleeting images.
Yeah.
Known Korean efforts to bust into anime, because one of the things is it's Sunrise, the Gundam series, or most of the more modern Gundam series, you know, like Gundam Wing, G Gundam, and stuff like that, is animated by Sunrise, which is actually a Korean animation studio.
That's the distinction that a lot of people seem to think, okay, it's a Japanese anime, therefore it's Japan. They did exactly what America did and Canada did, in that they actually outsourced it to China and Korea.
Yeah, it's, what do you call it, Transformers and G.I. Joe done by Sunbow.
Sunbow, who outsourced their stuff to Acom, Toye, which is a Japanese company, and I believe another one.
Tatsunoko did a lot of stuff for, I think Tatsunoko did some G.I. Joe related stuff at one point. Tatsunoko originally did Gatchaman, the original Gatchaman.
Sounds about right.
Tatsunoko as well. Tatsunoko is an interesting Japanese animation studio because while it's fondly remembered for things like Gatchaman and a lot of sort of cutesy anime stuff, Tatsunoko was at one point also one of the biggest producers of hentai anime, on the face of the earth. They produced a hell of a lot of disgusting pornography. speaking of disgusting pornography, shall we talk about Urotsuki Doji?
We might as well. After that, I think we're going to move on to current modern day anime, but sure, we'll go ahead with this.
Urotsuki Doji. Have you ever seen Urotsuki Doji, Matt?
I have.
What version did you watch?
I watched the UK one that is currently circulating around YouTube. And to be absolutely honest, I know how many edits that had to go through before the BFCC could actually put it out.
Yeah, and that's just the first film.
And that is just the first film. They couldn't get up to numbers 3 or 4. They went as far as number 2 before they gave up the ghost on that one, even though it was their highest bloody earner.
Yeah.
They just couldn't be bothered with the legal mumbo-jumbo anymore.
Basically what happened with Urotsuki Doji was originally, its original Japanese release was nearly 3 hours long. And that version of that has never ever been released anywhere outside of Japan. Because, for obvious reasons, by the time it made its way over here for Manga UK to have a crack at releasing it, they had to cut so much out of the film that they were only actually left with about 45 minutes worth of footage. So what they did was they got onto the original animation studios and said, can you produce less graphic versions of these scenes? Because basically 45 minutes was no good whatsoever for telling what is quite an intricate story. This is basically, bearing in mind, this is just the first film. I happen to have seen all five Rotsuki Doji films in their original uncut forms, and I can say that the original one, Rotsuki Doji Legend of the Overfiend, very, very much did deserve to get a lot of the cuts that it did. There's some very horrible stuff in there, which most of which would probably consider illegal.
Yeah, considering it was set in high school.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Rotsuki Doji 2 didn't do so bad when it made its way westward. It did have a lot of shocking stuff in it, and a lot of... because basically, the Rotsuki Doji series was the series that gave birth to the whole demon rape subgenre.
Yeah.
Or rape subgenre. The first film did feature that quite heavily, and there was a lot of very, very, very graphic and very, very explicit scenes. Basically,
yeah.
Graphic.
I'll stop it there, and I'll just say these three simple words. Vaginal milking machine.
Yes.
That just sums up the whole of that film.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I say. The first two, I think Manga UK actually, they managed to successfully release them in sort of Western Europe after they'd gone through several rounds of cuts, which left over the storyline that was left over for the Western release was all right. It was Pothole City, but it was okay to tell the basic story. Parts 3, 4, and 5 unfortunately didn't fare too well, because part 3, which was called Inferno Road, I think it was, basically dispensed with the main characters of the first two films and introduced new characters to try and carry on the storyline. Didn't do too well, but by that time the Rotsuki Doji series had basically degenerated into being nothing but hardcore animated pornography. Because then you get to part 4 and part 5, it's just literally, porn with a few talky bits in. Like that. That's what I say, which is a shame because it was a really good story to start off with, and then they realised that they were going to get more attention just by putting a lot of pornography in there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's like I say, I mean, I've seen all of the they did do new Rotsuki Doji at one point, which sort of updated the animation style and made basically told a similar but different story. I've seen new Rotsuki Doji, the first one, I think it is, which is basically the same story as the original first film. It's just slightly tweaked. It's not as good. They've made it a bit more sci-fi instead of sort of science fantasy. But it's not bad. It's like I say, it's Rotsuki Doji. And as well, Rotsuki Doji is another one of the rites of passage that I tend to notice from people that are into anime. You've either seen it or you haven't.
Yeah, I must admit, from what I've seen of the Bank of UK dub of this, I'm just not interested in any other cut. Because, see, I'm not a prude, but I would... If they're going to use fan service and they're going to use shocking material, there has to be a reason behind it, past the fact that they just want to be sensationalist.
Yeah.
And Legend of the Overfiend is the worst kind of OVA guilty of this, where you have no real connection with any of the characters because they are there purely to shock. I mean, you have the schoolgirl variant who is under the age of 16, either sexually assaulted or even just normal sexual intercourse in the most graphic ways possible. And then our hero, one of our first scenes of him is masturbating in a locker in the girls' changing room. All of this stuff, it just leaves me cold and I really, really don't like it. We will eventually cover Legend of the Overfiend in a later roundtable discussion, but just putting it out there, I'm not a fan.
No, a lot of people aren't. It's like I say, I don't mind it, but it's not, it's not something like, oh, I must sit and watch that, tentacle rape porn. I won't get some popcorn and bottle of pop and sit down. Yeah, but that's what I say. It's Rotsuki Doji. It's it's one of it's like I say, it's a rite of passage. You've either seen it or you haven't, and then when you watch it, you either like it or you don't. There's no, yeah, we're all right. You know?
I think it's one of those that if you're the sort of person who said, oh, I've been there, done that, bought the T-shirt when it comes to anime, you haven't said that until you've seen this show.
No.
That's really all I can say. I mean, if you sort of want to be like an anime historian, it is important you see this. I mean, it's important you see things like Barefoot Gen, for Christ's sake.
I mean, I can actually remember Manga Mania having a special feature on the Urotsuki Doji films. And it discussed at length. It was basically one of the guys from the magazine had gone down to the BBFC to discuss, you know, to discuss the cuts that were being made. At the time, I think that was when Urotsuki Doji Part 4 was about to be released on video.
Mm.
And he went down just basically to discuss the cuts that were going to be made to it and, you know, get the guy from the BBFC to explain why. And he said there, it says basically, it says, if I can remember from the article, I'm going to have to paraphrase because it was a long, long time ago that I read this. But the guy basically said, why won't you release this film uncut? And the guy from BBFC said, basically, it says, because if we released it uncut, we would actually be breaking the law. Because there's some of the depictions of stuff in it. And he says, at no point during this article will we be showing any screenshots from this film, because most of them we're not actually allowed to show because they're classed as pornography.
Yeah.
And he said, you know, during the interview, the guy showed him, basically a videotape containing scenes that were going to be cut from it, which he said he was allowed to talk about but wasn't allowed to describe in great detail kind of thing. One of the scenes that was described was the scene from the fourth film, I think it's the fourth film, or it might be the third, I can't remember off the top of my head, which was dubbed The Rape of a Lector, because it was a particular... And it is, I've actually seen the full scene, obviously, in the uncut version, and it is very, well, to say it's very distasteful is a bit of an understatement, and trust me, when you know me, you know I've got a strong stomach.
Yeah.
But that's what I say, it's one of the things, that it's like I said there, a lot of people say about the editing of Japanese stuff for the Western market, and how, you know, it shouldn't be touched, and, you know, just let us decide and things like that. There are some things though that are obscene.
Yeah.
They are just obscene, and obviously, you know, they have to stay within the laws of the country it's being released in. So basically, scenes of, you know, preteen girls having huge tentacles shoved up their arses and things like that. It's not ever going to get released on video.
Yeah.
How many people campaign for freedom of speech and stuff like that? You know, it's just things like that shouldn't really be available for anybody just to watch and buy.
Yeah, I mean, to be absolutely honest, we live in a time where we're very, very entitled to our opinion. But at the same time, if a movie like this got a worldwide release here now, I can imagine there'll be a lot of uproar.
Yeah, I mean, look at the... I've seen posters today advertising the 50 Shades of Grey film. And having read the book, I can quite categorically state that the vast majority of material in that book will not be included in the film.
Yeah, and even if it isn't, I have no interest in that film at all because it is abuse.
It is abuse, yeah.
It is abuse. It's just not for me, that film, or that book for that matter.
No. I sat and read the book just to see what all the fin furor was about or what it was about. And it's like I say, the book itself is an extremely badly written, boring thing. It's just basically it's sex scenes with bits in, and the sex scenes themselves aren't even that well written.
Yeah.
At no point. I mean, I know quite a few people who've read it, and everybody said at no point whilst reading the book did any of them feel any kind of sexual arousal.
Yeah.
You know, it's the book itself. It's somewhat sort of similar along the lines of you know, the film Sallow. You know, you must have seen Sallow. I've sent you the link on those how many times.
I think
that film, it's. There are sexual scenes in that film, but at no point while watching that film will you become sexually aroused in any way.
No.
That was what the film was designed to do. It was designed to not be arousing in any way, shape, or form.
Mm.
And it was basically a film about sadism, which is what 50 Shades of Grey is about, and in many ways that's what a lot of the Japanese hentai stuff in the hentai genre is about. It's not about sexual arousal or titillation at all. It's more about deriving pleasure from sadism. I know sadism is a very big thing in Japan. It's part of the cultural identity.
Well, I mean, you could just look at any sort of porno movie from that country where you could tell that she's sort of playing the victim half the time. Not that I'm admitting to watching porn in any way, of course, but you can tell, and it is disturbing, and it's just not for me. Anyway, let's move on. I'm just going to bring back a point I started but didn't quite finish when we were talking about One Piece. The thing about 4Kids was they just didn't know what they were getting themselves in for when they got hold of One Piece. They thought it was just going to be a happy-go-lucky little pirate show with the Rubber Man without actually looking in depth into the story. When you think about it, there's actually quite a lot of brutal death, not glorified, not shown, but heavily implied, and it's very, very, it becomes a very dark show by its very nature.
Yeah. A lot of the death and violence in One Piece is mainly what they would call heroic bloodshed.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, as anybody who's watched any films that have been directed by John Woo, stuff like that, you know, heroic bloodshed's okay in them, so... But then again, when you're making a cartoon aimed at children, obviously, you know, it you have to draw the line somewhere, and unfortunately, 4Kids drew it a little bit too low.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's like I say, I mean, there are several videos on YouTube which have scene comparisons from the original version of One Piece, and then they'll play the 4Kids version of One Piece. There was one video I watched, I can't remember which character it was, basically explaining his background. You know, the Japanese version explained his background. It went into, you know, a lot of detail about why he was about to attack this bloke that was walking down the street. And then, you know, the whole scene was about 10 minutes long. The 4Kids version was less than 90 seconds.
Yeah.
You lost, you know, a good 7 minutes of backstory and everything to understand this character's motivation. Just yeah. It was a little bit too violent for them. You know?
Yeah, and because of that, when it came to them... to give up the rights, they gave them up willingly because they knew they could not adapt this any further. They knew by that point it's just going to keep on this trend and it's going to cost us more money to reversion this series than humanly possible.
Especially when you've got the series' original creator openly berating you for what you've done to his work.
Yeah. So that's why they then gave up the rights. Funimation picked up the rights and continued airing One Piece from the point where 4Kids dropped the license. They didn't lose it. They just openly let it fall out of their hands.
Yeah.
And then they went back and redubbed the episodes up to that point.
Yeah.
But for the little time, Funimation just picked the ball up and just continued on.
Mm.
Kind of like what they did with Dragon Ball Z after the Ocean Group temporarily lost the dubbing, or they caught up with the show or something like that. I don't actually remember the ins and outs of it.
Of Dragon Ball Z... From what I recall, Dragon Ball Z originally started with, I think it was Pioneer started, and they dubbed most of the Saiyan saga, and then they dropped it, and Funimation picked it up until round about the, I think it was the Android saga?
Mm-hmm.
Ocean took over and did everything from the Ocean saga right up to Kid Buu, and then it was the Ocean dub of it wasn't terribly popular. So Funimation, I think Funimation took it up from where they left off and redid it as, again, you know, using all the same voice actors that they'd used originally, you know, like Chris Sabat and everything.
Yeah.
And the differences between the versions, you know, the Ocean dub and the Funimation dub were slight. Both told the same storyline, but the Funimation dub is generally regarded as the more superior one.
Yeah.
Funimation were obviously forced to edit out large sections of, particularly the Saiyan saga, due to, you know, the graphic violence and stuff like that. But they did actually, I do know Funimation did do not unedited versions, but they did more adult versions, or is it R18 or whatever it's called, you know, basically the equivalent to sort of the 15 or 18 stiff.
Well, it's still Funimation dubbing it now, and they did go back to the well, and that's where we got the orange boxes from. Those were all the shows unedited and basically redubbed from scratch.
Yeah.
All of the shows came out, so Funimation's still doing it to this day because they're the ones dubbing Dragon Ball Kai.
Yeah, I was going to say about Dragon Ball Kai, I've never actually watched that, but I have heard bad things about it.
No, I actually quite like Kai, but it's a case of I already know where the story goes. They do snake way quite quickly. It's something like along the lines of about 3 episodes.
Yeah.
You know, that gives you a scale, considering how long it took for him to cross Snake Way to begin with.
Yeah. I mean, I've got to admit, the Snake Way part does drag on a bit.
Mm. And he gets it done in literally, like, if this was like a aired 5 times a week, he got it done in about half a week.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, so that is a...
Yeah. I mean, it's who was it that did the GT?
It was Funimation, and there was 2 dubs, because there was another one done by Ocean Group for Canada. We got that version on TV.
Yeah.
And then Funimation did it again, and that's where we got a Welcome to the Grand Tour, that crap. And then they dubbed it again for DVD, and that's where you got the Vic Mignola theme tune from.
I mean, the weird thing is, I can remember once I went into a game shop and somebody put, I think it was one of the Dragon Ball Z games on, I think it was on the Wii or something like that, and they got it up on the big screen. And it was playing Rock the Dragon. And I was like, oh God, I haven't heard this for years. And like, well, what is it? I'm like, ah! You know? And it's a... I said to him, I said, you've never heard Rock the Dragon? And he's like, no. He says, what is it? Like, I said, it's theme tune to Dragon Ball Z. And he's like, no, it isn't. So I'm like, yeah, it is. And the only one he'd ever heard was the, you know, the ocean one.
Is it the one that was sort of Rock the Dragon light? That was Funimation.
Was it?
When they picked the ball up from the original Saiyan Saga, that's the one that had Rock the Dragon.
Hmm.
Well, from there on in, they continued it on, and they were the ones who had the Saban light, because it was Shuki Levy that did Rock the Dragon.
Was it? Oh.
Or it was either him, or it was the guy that did the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers theme.
Yeah.
It was one or the other. It was technically both of them then. But Bruce Falconer, I think I'd like to say that was him.
Probably.
He did Rock the Dragon. I'm pretty certain of it. But when you got the one that was kind of like Rock the Dragon, you're like, Dragon, Dragon Ball, Dragon Ball Z. Dragon, Dragon Ball Z. That one. I think that was Funimation.
Yeah. But that's the only one he'd ever heard. And it was like, you know, and he's like, oh, yeah, I really like Dragon Ball. It's like, well, if you don't know what Rock the Dragon is, then you don't like Dragon Ball, do you?
I'd say that's kind of not fair. I mean, anybody has had exposure to Dragon Ball from various different places and various different roads. It's not their fault if they're unaware that there were other versions around there. They don't have full-on... They may not necessarily know this stuff, so I'm going to cut them some slack there.
Yeah. Elitist.
Anyway, on that note, we got our next segment, which is there anything in the world of manga, anime, or tokusatsu in the modern day that you're watching now?
Yes. The only animes, modern animes that I'm currently watching is Yu-Gi-Oh! Arc 5, which hasn't even been dubbed into English yet. It's only available via other means, subtitles. Basically, you know, sort of, whoever's doing the subtitling for it is doing a really, really good job, because they're doing it, you know, like how TV Nihon does Kamen Rider.
Yeah.
You know, and they've got it all in the right fonts and, you know, and everything there. They're doing it like that, and the dubbing, well, the fan subbing on it is really good. The other anime I'm currently watching, I'm not particularly enjoying, is Cardfight Vanguard G.
Oh, right. I remember you making a couple of Facebook posts about that. I've seen it, and I think it's a case of, okay, it's great. It's another anime based on a card game, and I kind of got my fill of that with Yu-Gi-Oh! So I'm actually watching Cardcaptor Sakura as well right now, so, you know.
Yeah. Oh, God, I haven't watched that for years. I've been watching Cardfight Vanguard G, and I can't say I'm enjoying it that much, to be fair. It's whereas the original Cardfight Vanguard, the original series, the second and third series were all quite good. They've not actually done the fourth series. They said they were skipping that so they could move on to Vanguard G, basically, to sell more cards. The first three series, I haven't seen series four, were okay. They had a decent paced storyline. Cardfight Vanguard G, though, I really don't know what they're doing with that. The main character, who's supposed to be the hero character, is a complete twat. The cartoon is just not enjoyable to watch at all. It's gone back to being... The first series of Cardfight Vanguard was rather slow, slow to watch, because for some reason they decided that it would be a good idea to have 2-3 episodes just on a card-by-card play of the game. Then they kind of figured out that people were particularly interested in that, they wanted to see some action. They've gone back to doing the card-by-card plays, and it's just not good at all.
Okay. I mean, at least going back to Yu-Gi-Oh!, I mean, is the storyline any better or worse than previous stories?
Right. The original series with, you know, actually that actually had Yugi in it. Yu-Gi-Oh! GX, a lot of people pan it, but I really like it. Yu-Gi-Oh! 5Ds, the less said that about that, the better. Unless you've watched it in Japanese, where the original Japanese version with subtitles, it's better in Japanese. It just loses too much in translation. Yu-Gi-Oh! Zexal, probably the less said about that, the better.
I've been reading that in the pages of Shonen Jump, and I'm not all that enamoured with the story.
Arc 5 is pretty good. See, what the thing was with Zexal is they were basically trying to reinvent the wheel, because Yuma was basically Yugi, but in the future. You know what I mean? And they tried kind of unsuccessfully to reinvent the wheel, and it didn't work. Zexal was crap. Arc V, Arc 5, or Arc V as I always call it, is quite good. It's the main character, Yuya, is a likeable enough character. They've just got round to, you know, sort of the tradition for long-running anime series is that the storyline sort of builds up, then you get about halfway through the series, and then there's like, you know, massive game-changer moment.
Yeah.
And everything builds up to a final end. We're just at the massive game-changer moment here where they've just sort of revealed what the kind of ongoing plot line is for the series. You know, all these things that happened in the earlier episodes that you were like, you know, what the fuck was that about? You know, it's all just basically being explained.
Where your scene setter episodes have now been and gone, so we know what the series is about. Now we need to know where it's heading, so there's the big reveal.
Yeah, there's the big reveal, and it's getting on its way to the end game. Which is, like I say, I've really enjoyed Arc 5 so far. You know, it's got a lot of interesting characters in it, and especially with relation to the card game as well. The series has introduced another new play mechanic to the card game, which in the real-life card game at the minute isn't a particularly viable game mechanic, but it will get there eventually.
I've got a couple of the decks, actually, from Excel, yeah. I think. I've got them from Toys R Us. Mm-hmm. Just trying to... I can't read them from over there, but one of them's like a Megazord / Combiner Robo type gimmick.
Yeah, I remember the pictures I saw, you got the Space-Time Showdown and the Gear Gaia starter decks, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, the Space-Time Showdown is the one that's got the new pendulum mechanic in it. It's a difficult one to get your head around if you're used to the original sort of play style of the game. It's like I say, the new pendulum mechanic isn't a game changer at the moment, but it's sort of getting there. It's like what they do with most card games, then they introduce a new mechanic and then they give it a couple of sets for you to sort of get used to it, and then they start, you know, really pumping in, you know, this, you know, you've got to use this, you know, kind of the game mechanic if you want to carry on playing kind of thing.
Yeah.
They did the same with Synchro, they did the same with XEs. So, you know, Pendulum, I reckon within the next, what, sort of 3-4 sets of the real-life card game, it will become a proper viable mechanic that, you know, people can actually use in order to play games to any degree of success.
Yeah.
But yeah, I've really enjoyed Arc 5 so far. I haven't really watched much more by way of modern anime, because a lot of modern anime I don't really get on with, because it seems to have gone down the road of being cuddly.
You know? I can possibly throw some anime your way that goes against the grain. I mean, there's Parasite the Maxim that I'm watching right now.
Yeah.
Do you know the actual basis for Parasite?
No.
Right. Basically, there's an organism that's invaded Earth, but we don't know about it. And they live inside these pods in flowers. So it's kind of like Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
Yeah, I was thinking.
They're tiny, like, little caterpillar / maggot type things, which burrow into your ear, eat your head from the inside out, and gain your full knowledge and all of that stuff.
Yeah.
Duplicate your head, mm-hmm. but control the rest of your body. So the head is the organism, but the rest of the body is human.
Yeah.
Making a secret invasion of the Earth. Now, our hero is one of these guys who have been possessed, but with a difference. He fell asleep with earbuds in his ears.
Yeah.
How the organisms go in, they'll try and find any orifice, so they'll try and get in your mouth, your nose, your ear. But they're relatively stupid, because they're effectively babies. Mm-hmm. So this bug tried to get in through his ears, couldn't, so burrowed into a pore in his right hand. Yeah. Which is his good hand, you know, the hand you would use if you want to do a quick hand shandy, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
that's the best analogy I can really give, really. Yeah. So it burrowed its way into the pore of his arm, and he went back to sleep after freaking out a bit. Mm-hmm. When he woke up, his hand was basically not his own, because the bug ate out his arm, duplicated the arm, replicated it, and is now a part of him.
Uh-huh.
And basically, the establishment episodes... is him slowly come to terms with the fact that he's got an organism for an arm.
Yeah, so it's a bit like Ankh there.
Sort of. Whereas the arm, that thing basically possesses the whole body. This thing is basically his arm.
Yeah.
And it's him come to terms with this thing, which can look at him and talk and morph and all this other stuff.
Yeah.
And it's the organism coming to terms with him as a human being, and him come to the terms with this organism in his arm, and that the fact that his life has now been... basically, it's gone to a point where it can never really return.
Yeah.
And it's interesting to see the pair of them adapt over time.
Mm.
So it's based on a manga that happened in the mid-90s, so it's got those kind of sensibilities that you and me watched when we were younger.
Yeah.
But obviously they're trying to force out the fact, okay, this is the modern days, we've got things like iPads and all of that instead of reading newspapers. But you can still tell it had the old 1990s style of storytelling involved. So that's Parasite the Maximum. And I think the other one I can say at the moment that I'm watching, I haven't watched it all, I've gone up to about episode 6 or 7 right now, and that is Psycho-Pass. And that's the one that has a little element of Logan's Run about it. It's got a little element of 1984 about it. Basically, you've got this system in place. It's a society where this mass sort of thing has been established that's able to read your mind and figures out whether you've got criminal thoughts. Any kind of criminal thoughts. Hmm. And the way the police force kind of works, they have these sort of holographic mascots.
Yeah.
The best kind of comparison I can give about this society, it's kind of like the Happiness Patrol from Doctor Who.
Yeah.
You've got to, in your mind, not think criminal thoughts, negativity, or anything like that. So their mascots are nice, smiley, happy things that you could find in Disney World.
Yeah.
But there's also an element of Cyber City Oedo 808 or the Dirty Dozen about it, because they have, in amongst their police force, a team of people called the Enforcers.
Yeah.
Who are people in society that were kicked out from society because they had dark thoughts.
Ah.
And were able to smell their own, and they're like analysts and all that other stuff.
Yeah.
So without going into full-on spoilers, I think that's a show to at least try in its early episodes, and either you're going to like it or you're going to hate it.
Yeah.
So there's two examples I can throw your way.
Yeah, I mean, I've just been thinking then. I mean, I've been watching... I've managed to get through watching Death Note.
Hmm.
I mean, that's a bit old school now, isn't it? Yeah.
It seems to be. I think Christ, when did Death Note come out? Must have been 2005, 2006 now?
Yeah.
So that's at least 9 to 10 years old. That's amazing.
Yeah, makes you feel old, that, doesn't it? I can remember when all the kids were into Death Note and they were all wandering around with little Death Note books and stuff like that. God, makes me feel old now.
Oh, it would make you feel old when you remember the fact that Full Metal Alchemist is at least 11 years old now.
Yeah. Yeah, and Cowboy Bebop and all stuff.
Well, Cowboy Bebop is, what, 1997, 1998?
Yeah.
That's late 90s.
Oh, God.
Yeah, I do this with Gruff all the time, and he hates me for it. I say, hey, Gruff, you know all the stuff you love? You know, that's at least 25 years old now. He's like, fuck off.
Oh, yeah, I hate it.
He hate you.
Well, it's like that thing that we're in, was it the paper where it said, this is the baby off Teletubbies, you know, and now we're 19, 20, something like that.
Yeah, at least, because I think Teletubbies started, ooh, Christ,
94, 95, something like that.
Oh, it's, yeah.
Remember one Christmas looking for a Tinky Winky and not getting one? Actually, I went to when they had a raffle, you know, a charity raffle, and they got a Tinky Winky, and, I must have spent about £20 on raffle tickets just to try and win it. And then I was like, well, the actual Tinky Winky itself is only £15, you know? Yeah. Like I say, I achieved, last Christmas, I achieved a Holy Grail by getting an original Buzz Lightyear.
Oh, man.
Only, how many, what, 90?
95, it's got to be 95, 96. Yeah. It has to have been, because he was like the most sought-after thing on Christmas. I think that was 96, that was my first Christmas back in England.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I say. I managed to get that, and that's what I say. I got that, and it's like, yeah, finally got a Buzz Lightyear after, oh my god, nearly 20 years.
Yeah, 19 years. You know, this Christmas, that would be 19 years since Buzz Lightyear was a thing.
Yeah.
That is amazing. But then again, you know, Gruff will go on, I feel so old, and I have to remind him, I am at least 4 years older than you. Shut the fuck up.
Shut up, Grandad.
Yeah. So I think we have drunk the modern well dry. I mean, unless you want to talk about Tokusatsu, I think we're done there.
Well, Tokusatsu wise, I'll admit I haven't actually watched any. I very, very much did not like Kamen Rider Gaim. I watched the first sort of dozen episodes and I just couldn't be bothered with it.
How far did you say you went in Gaim?
I think I got probably about halfway through the series. How many episodes is a series usually? About 26?
No, there's about 48 to 50 in a standard Tokusatsu show.
Yeah. Well, Decade wasn't. Decade was only about 50.
Yeah. I've got a theory that Decade was always intended to be just a filler show while they sort of refined Kamen Rider Double. I'm pretty certain, because I know they had ideas in the pipeline for Double around the same time they were finishing up Kiva, so...
But that's what I say. I tried watching Gaim and I just didn't gel with it. I've tried watching Kamen Rider Drive. While I initially quite liked it, I just cannot be bothered with it.
Yeah. I will say Kamen Rider Gaim, for anyone that went and did the earliest episodes of that show and that sort of gave up, that show turned around really freaking quick. I'd say late teens, 20, certain things were happening in that show that made it incredibly dark.
Yeah.
We're talking sort of like Kamen Rider Blade sort of territory.
I know what it is about Kamen Rider, but I really, really liked Decade. I really, really liked Double. I really, really liked...
O's.
Oh, God, I loved O's. Then I really, really liked Wizard. And I absolutely fucking adored Forze. But then after that, I don't know, it just seemed to lose something.
I think a lot of people are experiencing burnout because they literally engulfed a lot of these tokusatsu shows in one fell swoop because there was suddenly a big surge in people that were suddenly tokusatsu fans.
Yeah.
And I can kind of understand because with each peak, you're going to have a trough.
Yeah.
Also, you've got the people that came into a certain show, lapped it up, and then once the next show came on, you've got that thing of, well, it's not this show, so why bother?
Yeah.
And it was like, at least give it a chance.
Yeah. Oh, speaking of the tokusatsu, I absolutely adored Akiba Ranger.
Akiba Ranger?
Yeah.
Oh, that's pretty good. I still need to finish the season two, but I still think that the first season of that did a good enough job.
The first series is the better series. Second series comes along and does more of the same but slightly different kind of thing.
Hmm.
I remember when I finished watching series two and I was like, I really wish they'd do a series three, but then it's in hindsight, no, it's done what it needed to do.
Yeah, I mean, I'd be perfectly okay that they don't do any more Akiba Ranger shows.
No.
Because I don't think it was ever intended to be like a long-running show.
No, it's at the end of Series 1, it was pretty much all done and dusted. You know, it's the very final scene was basically the destruction of the entire Akiba Ranger universe.
Yeah.
You know, with the giant hand that come down and basically crushed
everything. Yeah, because it's the creator.
Yeah, the what is it? It's, I can't remember the name, but it's the assumed name that writers use when writing for Sentai series.
Basically, the David Agnew of Sentai.
Yeah.
Because if people don't know who David Agnew is, it was basically a pseudonym that multiple writers or the script editor of Doctor Who would adopt, and it was a name that the BBC utilised in a lot of its shows.
Yeah.
He was not just one guy; he was a series of guys or girls or people or producers. Sort of chipped in and got a show done, but they couldn't have their name put on. Orbito, I think, is the guy.
Something like that, yeah. Because it is, like I say, at the end of the first series, his hand appears and basically destroys the entire universe.
Yeah, because they were trying to stop the show from ending because they know that would be the end of their lives if they did.
Yeah, yeah. And then it's, like I say, it came back for a second series and they changed the Blue Ranger.
Yeah, she went off to do another job, I believe, so she couldn't do it.
She couldn't come back and do it. They changed the Blue Ranger. The Red Ranger stayed basically the same. The Yellow Ranger became a lot more weirder. And then they just, you know, like, did the usual Sentai thing of, you know, powering up and, you know, you've now got more powered up gadgets that are even more powerful than the ultimate powerful thing that you had the last series.
Yeah.
And then, well, obviously, they brought back Malchina because they just had to do that. They could just make a show with just her in it and I'd be quite happy.
Yeah, she's a porno actress.
In Japanese. Well, she's not... she's not... porno per se. It's that very special Japanese niche porno thing what they do where it's there's not actually, it's sort of like our equivalent kind of soft.
Hang on, I think I understand what you mean. Joe Guest,
yeah, that kind of thing. Yeah, like, yeah. Sort of softcore, but you know, there's no, you know, like,
she's a page three girl basically. She's a glamour model sort of person. Here's all my womenly bits.
Yeah. And she's done like videos, you know, basically she has done sort of like sex videos and things like that, but it's not pornography in the traditional sense.
No.
Kind of thing. But yeah,
titillation.
I'd be quite happy if they did just a series with just her in it. It'd be great. but yeah, that's what I say. The whole tokusatsu thing. I think I'm having a bit of a rest from it because, like I say, I wasn't terribly impressed with Gaim. I'm not bothered that much really with Drive.
No.
Sentai stuff doesn't really do it for me anymore. You know, I could try watching Garo for a bit.
First season and possibly the second season, yes, I believe you can. I think from the third season onwards, it was becoming more and more obvious that it became franchised.
I really enjoyed the Gavan and Scheider films they did.
That Scheider, oh my God, that Scheider movie.
Yeah.
Talk about bloodthirsty.
Oh God, yeah. But I would like to see more of that.
Mm.
yeah, you know, I'd like to see more of that. I'd like to see some, what to call it, VR troopers, but not VR troopers.
The Space Sheriff. The Metal Heroes.
Yeah, Metal Heroes. I would very much like to see more of that. I don't think it's going to happen, though. It might do, because they, Gavin and Scheider came out of nowhere and surprised everybody, I think.
Yeah, I mean, the Gavin one, I can understand, because that tallied up with it being the 30th anniversary of the Metal Heroes franchise, so I knew that there was a reason behind that one.
Yeah.
It's just all of a sudden Metal Heroes became relevant again, you know, after being dead and buried for like 10, 15 years.
Yeah.
So, it's getting a bit late now, so we're going to crack on. We've got two other bits of business to get through before the end of the show. Carl, have you thought long and hard about what you want to jettison into Icon 101?
Oh, yes. Two things I'd like to chuck in.
Just the one. That's part of the rules. Has to be one.
You choose. Okay.
But remember, I'm going to have to fight you on it as well.
Yeah. I could take the easy one, one that you've never heard of.
You could try.
I could try. Okay, you ready?
Yeah, go on.
Future card buddy fight.
Future card buddy fight.
Yeah, it's basically made by the same people that make Card Fight Vanguard.
Okay.
I managed, even though that they released their series completely for free on YouTube, I managed 10 episodes of it. I don't even know how I managed 10 episodes of it, to be honest, because it's just awful.
Right.
It's basically along the same lines as Vanguard. It's basically a cartoon designed to sell trading cards to children.
Mm.
Fortunately, it helps if the game itself that they're trying to sell is actually worth playing. It also helps when you make it an anime based on a card game that the characters are actually, you know, likeable and enjoyable to watch. Unfortunately, none of these apply to this series at all. Its entire concept is so ridiculous, it basically renders it unwatchable.
Right, so let's pick this apart. Is the show still airing?
Yes.
Is it liable that the card game is going to continue?
I can't really say, because although when the game first came out, there was a little interest in it, it soon died off.
Right.
But as far as I know, the company that makes the card game, Bushiroad, is still producing cards for it. It's just that it's very, very rare that you'll ever see anybody.
Right.
In this, anyway, I don't know about other countries. It could be horrendous. It could be even more popular than Vanguard. At the minute, the Bushiroad card game is basically, it's Vanguard is number one. V. Schwartz is number two,
right.
And there are the games, you know, pick up and play if you want to, sort of thing. But I would say that Buddy Fight is probably the least popular.
Right. Number one, I've never heard of the anime,
no.
So on retrospect, I can't really throw something in that I've got no sort of personal sort of attachment to. Number two,
with my second choice,
and that you've picked one. So if we give you another chance later down the road, you can use that, and we can fight again. Number two,
and I'm typing you what my second choice would have been.
Okay. Well, you can tell me in a second. I'm just going to finish up on this one. Number two, the card game is still going on, as is the anime. Even if it isn't popular now, there is a chance that it might become popular down the road. Yeah, I don't know. Again, no personal sort of viewing or anything, so I can't invest myself in it yet enough to actually warrant throwing it in.
Mm.
If you understand that. If the show had ended and there was nowhere for the card game to go and it was done and it was dusted,
yeah,
and I knew about it, I probably would have agreed with you.
Mm.
So unfortunately, that's your consolation prize. You get to keep that.
Oh, lovely. Thanks.
I will see it later on, and I might say, oh, that Carl was actually pretty right. So you could have a chance to fight me again on that one, but right here, right now, as the guy who's trying to judge whether it deserves to go in or not, I can't really say it can, because I haven't heard about it, and it's not over yet, so it might still have a chance.
Yeah, fair point. It is an obscure one.
Your second choice, your first choice that you would have chose to give me, probably... It depends. You have to give me context, because I would quite happily throw the English dub of Naruto in Icon 201, 101, or whatever name trick he wants to give it. because it is a terrible bloody dub, and the voice for Naruto in itself definitely deserves to be in that room, but it's not what you chose. Naruto the manga, I've got no problems with. I still read it.
The reason why I didn't go with Naruto as my first choice is my own actual viewing of it is quite limited. I've watched it. I didn't like it. I also dislike the way that it is horrendously overrated.
Oh, that shadow of a doubt is overrated.
It's basically, it's a softcore version of Dragon Ball Z.
It's a Shonen Jump manga, so by its very definition, it was always going to be structured pretty similar to Dragon Ball Z.
Yeah, it's basically a poor man's Dragon Ball Z, but it's horrendously overrated, and whenever you hear... Basically, when you see people go on about, oh, I'm so into anime, etc., 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 and you say, what anime have you seen? And they go, oh, Naruto. And it's like, yeah, what else have you seen? Oh, just Naruto.
But you, again, I can't really think too harshly of those people, because that might be their gateway into manga and anime later down the road.
Yeah, but being as Naruto has been going for years, and there are various different series of it with, you know, different characters doing different things, at some point you would have thought that somebody who watches Naruto, even the most hardcore, die-hard fan of Naruto, would have watched something else. I mean, hell, you know, you could be a hardcore Star Trek fan and still watch Star Wars and go, oh, yeah, you know, I quite like Star Wars.
Yeah.
Or something along those lines. You would expect that somebody that watched Naruto would have encountered something else at some point, you know, along a similar line, for example, Dragon Ball Z or something like that.
Yeah.
And have watched it and either gone, oh, yeah, that's okay, or, nah, that's just shit. You know, but the vast majority of Naruto fans that I seem to meet are entirely... Their entire experience of anime is based on nothing other than Naruto. And when you try and explain to them that there are other things out there, you know, oh, hey, try and give this a watch or give that a watch. And they're just completely dismissive.
Yeah.
They won't, you know, they won't go and watch this other thing because Naruto, you know. But yeah, but that's what my other choice would have been. But unfortunately, I can't really debate it very well at length because my own actual viewing experience of Naruto isn't that extensive.
Yeah.
I've been there, seen it, didn't like it.
Yeah, it really does depend on personal context. I mean, for me, I would have agreed with you wholeheartedly if it was the English dub. Absolutely without a shadow of a doubt, because I cannot stand it. But again, even if this was just a mission, probably wouldn't have been allowed in. Like I said, I'm a tough nut break. I will defend anything to this last hill, even if I don't personally agree with it. So there you go. You get to keep all of that lovely stuff as your consolation prize for appearing on this podcast.
Awesome.
Yeah, so you don't go away empty-handed. So the last order of business is, we're going to obviously be ending the show soon.
Yep.
Which music from Japanese anime, tokusatsu, etc., how would you like to close the show out on?
I think my current favourite anime tune is the theme tune to the first half of Yu-Gi-Oh! Arc 5. Believe, X Believe.
Awesome. So, Carl, where on the interwebs can people find you?
At the minute, I'm not really doing that much interweb related. I still do have my YouTube channel, which is, I don't know, since the change of name's over, I think it's still, if you still put in youtube.com/TW Pikachu, it'll probably get you there, or search for God Pikachu in the search engine on YouTube, you'll find me there. It's not getting updated as regularly as it was. I've really scaled back doing videos, so I'm just lacking inspiration or time to do it. I do maintain a blog, which I do reviews on, of at the minute mainly concentrating on sort of low budget and B-movie type films, occasional bits of talk about anime and gaming. That's called Pika's Naughty Corner. It's on eBlogger. I can't give you the address because I don't actually know it myself.
Well, give me a link later on and I'll put it in the show notes when I post it around the internet.
But that's it, really. I don't... it's just those two, really. YouTube and eBlogger. I don't do Twitter. I certainly will not ever do Tumblr. Ever.
I quit Tumblr. I it was too much for me.
Yeah, unfortunately, I don't have a radical enough conscience to start a page on Tumblr. You know, and basically find everything offensive for some reason. Yes, I don't really do that. I don't really guess much on people's things either, so it's like, oh, you may know me from this as well, because I don't really guess much on stuff anymore either.
Well, to be fair, I mean, when you signed up to do this, I was actually quite keen to have you on, because I knew that your not your taste, but your knowledge on anime was pretty similar to my own. I mean, we had pretty similar backgrounds of watching it on the TV due to previous conversations. So when you said you wanted to do this, I basically, you know, yeah, go for it. Yeah. Plus, I also knew I was going to have to double the length of this podcast, because usually I'm gunning to get these done for about an hour. And it's as of this recording, we're now at an hour and 52 minutes. So I knew it was going to be double the length. I mean, God help me when we get Mikey on the show, because...
If it's anything longer than 10 minutes, I'm not watching it.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, 5 minutes is the absolute zenith of podcasting, apparently, as of YouTube, because, you know, people can't swallow more than 5 minutes at a time. hey, little dig at people on YouTube there.
Old wounds.
Carl, thank you very much for being on the show. But it was a very good conversation, a really interesting one as well. So with that, say your goodbyes.
Goodbyes.
You can find this show on Facebook under Cyber Ritz. You can find the show on the Old Oil House. That's oldoilhouse.weebly.com. You can find us on the Old Oil House on Facebook and Twitter. And you can find me probably going mental over the amount of editing I'm going to have to do to clean up the audio on this show. This is Time Lord signing out. Be excellent to one another, because we are all one. And toodles. Bam, bam.